Hey everyone, how's it going? Welcome back to our second full Bassline transcription here. First one we did was Wayside, Back in Time. That's off that Chris Thiele album, How to Grow a Woman from the Ground. If you haven't checked that video out, highly recommend doing that first, as this one is covering some other topics that kind of are related to, but also kind of grow from that. But as you heard in the demo, as the intro that is, we're working with a super bluegrassy tune today. This is off an amazing Michael Cleveland and Flamekeeper album. I'm pretty sure most of you would know Michael Cleveland. He's like, you know, world-class fiddle player. Also like nicest guy in the world. He's a really good guy and plays a mean bluegrass fiddle. Arguably the best bluegrass fiddle player in the world, very specifically. Yeah, so this tune is just awesome. It's an old Bill Monroe song called 6 Feet Under the Ground, and Jason Moore, who's a really great session bass player, and you know, played in this band back in the day. This record is from the early 2000s, so he was back in the band back then, and played bass on this track, and just really intelligent bass playing. We'll talk over some details after I play through it, but while I play through it, I just really want you to focus on the range of what's going on. It's in C major, which is kind of funny. When you can hear the banjo capo, for those of you who have the bluegrass ear, the banjo capo is up on the 5th fret, which is a really different sound than open C position on banjo. For those of you who are a little confused, you just, you know, do some YouTube research on banjo capoing, because it does actually play a role on how you'd approach a bass line. But the banjo is way up on the 5th fret. So he's, you know, playing out of the G position, but having that capo on the 5th fret means that you're playing at a C. And I jokingly call this key B plus, because it kind of is like, has the same aggressive quality as B, you know, when you capo on the 4th fret. So you go up a capo position and you're in C, but it kind of has that B quality, you know, which is what makes it so in your face, is that banjo is really bright and punchy and high pitched. So, you know, it's a pretty aggressive sound. So I'll play it, you know, kind of the way that I'm hearing Jason do it on the record. But yeah, listen for range. It's in C major. For the most part, he's hanging on the C on the A string and that open G. That middle range is kind of where he's focused. And the C on the G string does get used as well. And at one point, he even goes down to the low F for that 4 chord. So all, you know, the range is pretty much from that low F to the high C, and just focus on how he's utilizing it and dividing sections by focusing on what range he's in, and then how they kind of meld together by the end. So let's go through this here. Let's see if I can press play and then get ready to play myself. All right. Thank you. an amazing, amazing rendition of that tune. To me, that's like as good as bluegrass gets, y'all. That's like an amazing, amazing tune, and great band. And yeah, just the clip, it's like a little bit up tempo, you know. I clipped it in around like 128 beats per minute. So if you want to practice this, you know, outside of the track, you can put your metronome on 128 and even slow it down if you want to work out some stuff. But yeah, so first question I have for you is like, what did you notice about the range? First thing I hope you picked up on is on that fiddle break, after the first chorus, he hits that high C, which is a great way of like dividing the section, right? It's very clear that we're in a new section right now. I also think about how Michael's break on this, Michael Cleveland, the fiddle player, you know, his break is very kind of like, it's almost light and kind of calm for what he usually does. You know, he's usually really in your face, but the break itself is like very like peaceful in a way. Let me see if I can pull it up. Just like for a fiddle break, this is unusually calm, especially for Michael Cleveland. Just check it out. You know, that is, it may not sound like it if you're not familiar with his playing or, you know, this really kind of bluegrassy sound, but that's pretty chill. And I think he also plays into the fact that it's the first break in the song, which is kind of typically it's a pretty relaxed spot, whoever's soloing there. It's not going to be high intensity. And the bass player, Jason Moore, is focusing on that. He's saying, okay, I can play in this higher register and I don't need like a ton of energy in that low end kind of growl and percussiveness. I can just back him up with a higher sound. And so yeah, it's really intentional, and it's not just about what instrument's playing, but also what kind of quality is that instrument giving off? Is it relaxed? Is it in your face, you know? Like looking at that next to the banjo break at the very end, that's the spot where you're hearing that really low part of the bass come out. You know? And I think most good bluegrass bass lines to me have a low point in them. That's what I called it. You know, this is a great example of it. It's like 75% through the song. Usually it's this last break, this last solo in the song. It's super high energy, in your face. It's like all guns blazing. And you get that really powerful low end of the bass. And it's just, you see how like on a song with this clip, he's not using the E string very much, you know? Just at the very end, he's using that low end. And think about that when you're playing. You really sticking in that middle register of the bass, especially on a song with this tempo, is essential. And having the access to get up to that high C on the G string and also go down to that low F on the E string are both great. So when you're making up your own bass lines or just, you know, playing in the jam, think about staying in that middle register for the most part. If it's super, super fast, maybe stick a little higher. If it's really slow and kind of like a ballad, you can use that low string more. So those are the two big moments of like range differentiation. I'll just, you know, mention after that banjo break, last chorus, you're getting all those chromatic runs. It's much less root fifth oriented. And then it comes back to it here. So that first half of the chorus, there's a lot of chromatic runs in there. Again, he's saying, you know, you don't hear that the rest of the song. He's saving it for that big, big up moment at the very end. For some of those grace notes you're hearing, what's happening is he's playing a grace note on the A string and then hitting the F with his pointer finger. So it's the same technique we talked about in that ghost note video. Check that out again if you need a refresher. But he's not playing the note on the same string, I'm pretty sure. It's A string, kind of like C on the A string, ghost note, and then the F with your pointer finger. And also notice how he's elongating those notes beforehand. Building up tension, doing something new, and then releasing it to that chorus downbeat. Pretty awesome. Pretty awesome. So note length, that's kind of the main aspect of the note length in this bass line that's being varied. Yeah. And, you know, that's pretty much covers the bass line. It's really great. It's a really, really great bass line. And the song's great. This entire record has a lot of cool stuff on there. So I'll drop the record link in the chat below the video. But yeah, work through this and let me know if you have any questions. Also, use that slowdown tool on this video. You can slow down when I was playing through this bass line. If you want to learn it by ear, slow it down and just take it section by section. Really good way to learn. Also, you have the visual of me playing, obviously, too. So yeah, really awesome, y'all. Have a good week. Enjoy this, and I'll see you next time.